the 23rd of May 2023. Many thanks indeed for tuning in to Law Matters, a show that is educative, informative, and offers legal aid solution to what we face on our day-to-day lives. Tonight, we have a very interesting topic, the issue of homicide in the country. We have witnessed the increasing cases of homicide and questions have been raised. Is it an issue of the legal mechanism or is it an issue of the criminal justice system? We'll be interrogating that tonight. My name is Irene Mwangi. Be sure to send your questions and feedback concerning this particular show on our social media platforms at KUTV Kenya on Facebook, at KUTV underscore Kenya on Twitter, and KUTV Kenya on YouTube. But first, before we get into the nitty-gritties of this particular topic, let me allow my guest to introduce himself.
Good evening, viewers. My name is Charles Mugeni. I am an advocate of the High Court of Kenya. I practice in the firm of MCM Advocates LLP. Located in Westlands. I'm the managing partner.
All right, thank you so much.
Yes.
So, looking into the issue of homicide, the term homicide, it's more of a criminal term that, you know, many don't quite understand what really it's all about. So before we get into the deep discussion of homicide in Kenya in terms of the legal aspect, what is considered as homicide in the law?
Homicide is that killing someone by another.
Right.
Yes. It's simply put, it falls into three categories. We have murder, we have manslaughter, and infanticide.
Right.
Yeah, but generally, because I've heard you introducing that we've had cases of homicide in this country. We have cases of murder.
Okay.
Yeah.
When it's broken down into a case, it's either a murder case, a
manslaughter
case.
Okay.
But you cannot really contextualize it to be a homicide case.
No, homicide is a moving term. Yes.
Interesting perspective there.
Yes.
But given that you've said homicide, it's either murder, manslaughter, and
infanticide. Yes.
What really differentiates them into this, into the three terms?
So murder is that killing someone with an intention. You informed an intention to kill.
Or you had contemptualized it.
Yes.
The act of, yes, you know, killing someone.
Yes. Then manslaughter is what we can call accidental death. When you kill someone without intention, you do not form that intention, what you call menstrua.
Oh.
So in murder, there's menstrua, because a determined mind to commit the offense. When manslaughter, it occurred maybe in the course of a transaction where you did not intend.
But it happened.
Right. Then infanticide is that offense commonly associated with new mothers. That act of killing your child within the first 12 years after birth.
Okay.
Is what is called infanticide.
There's a time frame, 12
years? Yes, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, 12 months, not 12 years, yeah, 12 months. Mm-hmm. Yes.
All right, so in terms of what the penal code will say in terms of jailing somebody or sentencing somebody to either murder, manslaughter, and or infanticide, what does the court really look into before sentencing somebody into the three particular aspects?
Of course, the court will look at the evidence that has been brought before it. The court will not interrogate what is reported in the media. The court will interrogate the facts that are brought before the court by the prosecution to its witnesses, and then also interrogate the evidence given by the accused person, that is in the court. The place is the accused person and all the defense.
Right.
Yes, because you know there are instances where the court will be charged with murder, but at the close of the prosecution case, the court will find that they have not established what we call a prima facie case to enable you to put in a defense. Then they acquit you. But if they find that there are reasons to hear your side of the story, they place you on a defense. Then once you've been placed on a defense, then you'll be able now to give your version of the story, which may lead the court to either make a determination that there was a the prosecutor not prove your case beyond reasonable doubt, or maybe you've proffered a defense that is reasonable. yes.
which now overrules what yes. the prosecution yes. has yeah. done so far. Yeah. Okay, now, here in the country, we have had issues of murder, manslaughter, and what we've termed as infanticide. But in terms of real case scenarios, there have happened to be cases whereby you wanted to murder somebody, but unfortunately or fortunately, actually it's fortunately, the person did not die. But within the harm it caused to the person makes the person to die after, say, 6 months or maybe 12 months. Is that case considered as murder, even though the incident did not happen at the time when you executed the act?
Oh, yeah, the law places separation. Mm-hmm. If you inflict injury onto someone, then that person dies within 12 months.
Oh, the time frame is 12
months. Yes, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that can be charged with murder. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, what does the court use to ascertain that the act you did led to you being charged with murder? Because sometimes you might have caused harm to the individual, but because of pre-existing condition of the person, that condition led to the person to die. So how do they differentiate between it's a pre-existing condition and this is the harm that caused this to happen?
No, there's an element in the murder trial where the disease has been subjected to a post-mortem. So the post-mortem report will show the cause of death. That's the primary document that the court will use to determine the cause of death. Mm-hmm. Because if the post-mortem says that this person got a shock and that shock was not in any way related to the act done by the accused person, then they cannot be held that person liable for the death. Yes.
Now, according to the statistics that were revealed, is that between 2019 and 2021, there had been increase in terms of homicide incidents. Let's not call those cases, because now it's all about the incidents. And the question was raised as to why the cases were on the rise. What is causing this particular increase? What can be cited? Is it an issue of the legal loophole in terms of the penal code, or is it an issue of the moral society, how the fabric has been, torn?
I think the last time I appeared in the show, I told you that crime is about how we conduct ourselves as individuals. It has nothing to do with whether there's law, whether there's a loophole in law or not. At the commission stage, perhaps if your question was we've seen cases, instances where people are taken to court but are acquitted, maybe that one now we can argue that maybe there's a loophole in the law, or there's a loophole in the way our police conduct investigations and stuff. Mm-hmm. But we cannot peg the commission of the crime on loopholes in law. Mm-hmm. Yes, because even if you put 1,000 police officers there, that will not stop me from planning to kill you. Mm-hmm. Because we've seen cases, actually, rising cases that we have where men are killed, women or women are killed, people who are in a relationship. Mm-hmm. Those are people who stay together in a room, and these offenses are committed at night. You know, the police are not the police you in your house.
Yeah,
so it's all about the moral aspect.
It then brings the question of, in terms of vision, in terms of cases that we have witnessed, and they've caused an uproar in the community. But when it comes to the criminal justice system, or when the case is brought in a court of law, it does not see the light of day in terms of people being found culpable of these particular cases. Is now that being cited to a legal loophole?
No, it's not a legal loophole. Because you see, the penal code defines what is murder, and it creates the crimes of murder. Now it's upon our investigative agencies to thoroughly investigate these cases, so that the evidence that they bring to court is a watertight evidence that can convict convict. You know, court does not convict on rumors, doesn't convict on newspaper reports, it doesn't convict on the societal feeling. See, the society might feel this is wrong. However you say this is wrong, but the evidence that has been brought before court is not sufficient to sustain a conviction, the court will not convict.
Right.
Yeah, no matter what you say in TVs or radios or newspapers.
They, of course, they can't be, you know, derailed by emotions.
Yes.
Is a recent case we saw of a young individual, I think Jeff Mwathi. There was a lot of, you know, emotions concerning that particular case, but at the end of the day, the post-mortem still did not lead or incline to the emotion perspective of that.
Because there's that aspect of beyond reasonable doubt. The court will only convict where the prosecution has brought evidence that is beyond reasonable doubt to show that this person committed this offense.
All right. Now, when you look into the case of murder and manslaughter, most of the cases, when somebody is charged, the charge is murder. But when it comes to the sentencing, it turns to be a manslaughter. And sometimes most of, you know, the families that are aggrieved in terms of the victims who have been killed, they feel like justice has not been offered because they felt this was more of a murder case than a manslaughter case. Tell us about how this moves from a murder to a manslaughter, and in terms of, you know, the timelines when somebody can be sentenced to murder and manslaughter.
Yeah, as I told you, these, that element of intention that's here, you had formed an intention to what you call malice aforethought, is where you had formed an intention, you had a plan to kill this person. So that's when court will convict. Even prosecution proves that. But there are circumstances whereby, yes, this person was killed, but there was not that aspect of malice. So at the end of the day, the prosecution will charge you with murder. But the evidence standard in court may lead to manslaughter. So the court will convict you with that lesser offense of manslaughter.
But
because the law states that if you read our Criminal Procedure Act, Criminal Procedure Code, the law allows a judicial officer, a magistrate or a judge to convict on an offense that the accused person is not charged with, provided it is a lesser offense and the prosecution have established. So if you are charged with murder, but the facts that the prosecution have brought to court point out to commission of a lesser offense of manslaughter, then the court will convict you and sentence you for manslaughter.
So, which begs the question, if the court has decided, if the prosecution is coming to a court of law to say that so-and-so has committed murder, yet they clearly sometimes know that the evidence that they have is not enough for that particular threshold, why do they jump to the highest penalty instead of working with the evidence that they have at the time? Because sometimes we have seen cases of whereby the prosecution is in the court of law, somebody is charged with murder, but they go ahead and tell the judge or the magistrate to give them more time to seek more evidence, yet according to them, they feel like murder will have been best sought, but what they have currently at the table does not quite fit the offense that they have.
I will say that it's a trial strategy.
It's a strategy.
Yes, it's a strategy.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we say, if you can't reach, you jump high so that you can somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So let me give a perfect example. Before the 2010 Constitution, people ran for president.
Mm-hmm.
One of the requirements for you to run for president, you had to run for MP.
Okay.
So now, a president is a woman. So you run for president. Then people in your village will get excited that you're running for president and they give you all the votes for MP. So, but unanguka president, unanguka back MP. So it's a trial strategy. The prosecution will know that the evidence that I have points out to manslaughter. And they will choose to prefer charges the murder.
Okay.
So that now it's the court to make a determination. Because what happens when you charge with manslaughter and then you find that you cannot even prove that case of manslaughter. Mm-hmm. But to address your concern, what the prosecution is actually doing and what the court is encouraging is where you find that the case person has been charged with murder, but the facts point to manslaughter, in most, so that we save on judicial time, we entered into plea bargaining. And I think the last time I was here, I gave an example where I was pleading someone, they were charged with murder, but after the fourth, fifth witness had testified, the judge was like, no, this is a case you go for plea bargaining. So plea bargaining is where now you plead guilty to lesser offense of manslaughter. So the prosecutor has brought you to court and charged with murder, and the facts show that yes, you killed this person, but you did not have intention to do that. Now they will get into a plea bargain, and you'll be convicted on a plea of guilty, but having pleaded guilty to an offense of manslaughter. That is if you know and the facts can establish that. So, but sometimes when, for example, I'm representing someone who's been accused of murder, and the facts point to manslaughter, I can still choose to proceed with that trial and attack both the offense of murder and the manslaughter to ensure that maybe at the close of the case, the prosecution is not established. Indeed, that manslaughter. Right. Because, for example, if I kill someone in self-defense, I do not have the intention.
Yeah.
So that's manslaughter. But I had a reasonable defense of self-defense, for example,
right,
or defense to property.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you so much. Of course, once we get back, I want us to take a short break because of time. We'll be looking into the issue of this particular cases of homicide in terms of murder and manslaughter. Are they in degrees, or how do they measure that? To what degree did this person commit this particular crime? But we'll be doing that after this break. We're taking a short break, but once we get back, we'll be looking into murder, manslaughter, what are the terms, what does the law say concerning these particular crimes? Do stay with us.
To which people are affected by COVID seems to be a matter of luck. Some people who are young and fit are infected upon their first contact with the virus. Others, like Julia, don't get it. She recently spent an hour and a half having breakfast with her father, who tested positive the same day. Her boyfriend also brought the virus home 2 weeks later.
Da waren wir.
We spent 3 days together. He was positive with a CT value of 21, and we assumed there was no point in isolating after we'd already been around each other for so long. But after that, nothing else really happened.
Julia remained healthy. Researchers have different theories about why certain people are less susceptible to COVID than others. It could be their immune system, a question of timing, or their blood type.
As far as I know, my blood type is O negative. Maybe that's why.
My blood type's O. I've not been infected, but I don't think that's why.
André Franke is a molecular biologist. With his team, he's been investigating genetic peculiarities that could help explain why some people are better protected from an infection than others. Their research led them to consider blood type. Whether a person's blood type is A, B, or O appears to play a major role.
We were able to observe a clear relationship between ABO blood group and susceptibility to an infection.
Various studies carried out all over the world have shown that people whose blood type is O are less likely to be infected with COVID than people with other blood types. That likely has to do with the compatibility of the blood types with each other. Just a reminder, the different blood groups have different antigens in their blood cells. Only blood group O has no antigens. That's why people with blood type O can donate blood to anyone. Conversely, people with blood type O can't receive blood from people with other blood types. The antigens in the blood of the other blood groups causes their bodies to reject it during transfusions. A research team in France has a theory. Maybe infections with people who have different blood types operate under the same principle. That would mean a person with blood type O can't be easily infected by people with other blood types. However, if they do get infected, they can spread the virus very easily to other people.
That makes sense, because when viruses reproduce in the somatic cells, they combine with proteins and other materials from a human host. In this case, it's the blood group antigens.
Julia also suspected that her blood type played a role in her apparent immunity to COVID, but a blood test revealed she's in blood group A, so in her case, the reason is still a mystery.
Fashionistas, looking for a show that brings you the latest in the world of fashion, glamour, creativity, and style? Fashion Diaries got you sorted as we explore street fashion, modeling, runways, red carpet events, and so much more.
Catch me, Ashley Asachi, as we unlock the greatest fashion event. Keep it locked.
Focus on Health is a show that creates awareness on matters health and informs you on various diseases, their causes, treatment, prevention, coping, and support. So join me, Bari Michelle, every Thursday at 7:30 p.m. only on KUTV. You can also follow us on our social media platforms at KUTV Focus on Health on Facebook and also on YouTube, and Health Focus on Instagram, because your health is your wealth. Stay safe and stay healthy.
Tonight, we're discussing the issue of homicide incidents in the country, and we're having Wakili Charles Mwalimu giving us details concerning what the law says, the penal code, in terms of homicide incidents. Now, Wakili, before we took a break, we were looking into what circumstances that an offence can be termed either murder or a manslaughter. And therefore, we have had countries in other jurisdictions say that they have first-class and second-class murder, in terms of what the penal court says in the country. Do we categorize these particular cases, or what does the law say?
In Kenya, we do not categorize murders to either first degree murder or second degree murder, because our penal code defines what amounts to murder, and it extensively defines what amounts to malice aforethought.
Well,
malice aforethought is that intention to kill.
Okay.
You may find that whether, you know, once the court establishes the trial of malice aforethought, it won't whether you just hit this person once and he died, or you kata, it won't
look into the severity of the
action. Yeah, it won't look at the severity of the action.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, when they say concerning homicide, there's a situation whereby you can commit murder. There was the intention, but the intention had a specific cause. There's something that triggered either hate or whatever emotion that might happen at the time of the incident. Do we categorize homicide incidents here in Kenya in terms of what triggered that particular action?
No, what triggered that particular action is what is interrogated.
Okay.
Establishing that it's malice aforethought. For example, if you stab someone 4 times and that person dies, you know, it means you had the opportunity to come back to your senses. When I stab you the first time, I have the opportunity to come back to my senses and say, no, this person may die. So if someone is stabbed once and that person dies, you can always now argue that there is no malice aforethought. No, that can help you in attacking that element, because the element of malice aforethought is the most critical element. And it's one that differentiates between murder and manslaughter. Yeah, once you remove that element, then automatically you won't be convicted.
The fact that you stabbed somebody once and they died can be used to put up a defense in a court of law if somebody else committed the same crime but stabbed somebody several times.
Yeah, for example, you said that element of maybe provocation, that you just reacted to something. So, you know, if you provoke me and I stab you once,
okay,
I can argue that was provocation.
Right.
But if I stab you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you cannot argue that that fit of rage did not at some point
make you to commit that particular crime.
To come back to your senses and say no. And for example, let me give this example. A married man walks into his bedroom and finds his wife in bed with another man.
Okay.
You run to the kitchen or to your store to pick a panga and come and chop this man.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot convince God that you acted out of anger or provocation because you found your wife in bed.
Mm-hmm.
But if I walk into my wife and I, in a fit of rage, instantly pick him to your ngumi and he dies, or I just pick a bedside stool and hit him, then you can always argue that you did not have, you know, the timeline of reaction.
Oh, so it's all about the timeline.
Yeah.
The court looks into
it. Yeah, you can argue.
Did you contemplate this particular thought?
Did you have the time to form an intention to kill?
Mm-hmm.
So if the reaction was instant,
mm-hmm,
you can always argue that there was no intention.
Okay.
I was in a fit of rage.
Mm-hmm.
I felt provoked.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how, you know, you attack that element of malice aforethought.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, what happens when somebody commits murder in self-defense? Given that murder is murder, but I've committed this offense in self-defense, how then does the court look into that particular scenario?
When an accused person wants to rely on the self-defense as a defense, it is the burden usually going to demonstrate that he acted in self-defense.
Mm-hmm.
That's where people go wrong, because you wait until the last prosecution witness has testified, then during your defense you start saying that I acted in self-defense. But during the hearing, when the prosecution was bringing in the witnesses, you did not cross-examine the witnesses to point in a certain way to give the case at a certain direction.
So you must do it from a point of the cross-examination and not...
not at the end. So that now the court will be able to see, yes, this person acted in self-defense.
Okay.
Yeah. So you cannot say, you know, the prosecutor will say that you saw X killed by this and this. So it's upon you, when you're asking the witness who is testifying, you should ask them questions pointing towards the direction that you're acting in self-defense.
Okay.
And the self-defense is treated as an absolute defense.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it means that you will not be...
Yeah, no,
what do they mean when they say absolute?
Absolute is it's a defense that the court can rely on to acquit you.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You've pointed out that sometimes when the prosecution brings a case, it's murder. And then when the judge is sentencing, it becomes manslaughter. When the prosecution say, for example, it's manslaughter, but from where the judge or the magistrate sits, after listening to both sides, that is the prosecution and defense, finds out that there might be a bigger offense, does the judge have the leeway to uphold a higher offense in those particular...
No, the judge cannot convict you for a bigger offense than the one that you're charged with.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're charged with manslaughter and the facts establish that it's actually murder,
mm-hmm.
unless the prosecution applies to amend the charge.
Is it applicable?
Yes.
And what are the timelines in terms of...
No, the prosecution can amend the charge at any moment
mm-hmm.
before the close of the case.
Okay.
So if they have not amended, the judge will not convict you for murder.
Okay.
Yes.
Then it raises the concern about, in terms of murder cases, they say you prove a case beyond a reasonable doubt.
Yeah.
But in most cases, which has been the complaint that a case is murder, but at the tail end, the judge is not convinced, and a case now becomes manslaughter. In terms of our prosecution, given that you've said that the law has no issue because everything is clearly defined, does it mean that the prosecution is not well boosted to bring a case to bring evidence before court to show that this person committed this crime beyond reasonable doubt?
You know, in the criminal justice system, we have police who act as investigators,
okay.
and our prosecutors are not investigators.
Mm. So is the police?
It is the police that will arrest. They will answer the court statements. They actually, at some point, they once will recommend to the DPP that to find that this offense has been established. But now you see, the file has to go to the DPP for approval.
Yeah.
So the ODPP has that power to go through,
mm-hmm.
the file, mm-hmm. and find, establish whether the facts lead to murder mm-hmm. or the facts lead to manslaughter.
So that now he can prefer which charge.
To prefer upon the accused person. So it's not the duty of the prosecutor to investigate.
Mm-hmm.
The prosecutor will only evaluate the evidence that has been brought forth by the investigative agencies.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why we criminal law practitioners take advantage.
Okay.
Yeah, because you know, you're here arguing this case with me, mm-hmm. but you do not investigate.
You don't know what are the details of
yes.
this particular case.
Yeah.
Is that therefore to mean that a murder case, and is this now the scenario that happens in most of the murder cases? Because many have said that when a case is murder, sometimes it's seeing justice being delivered is quite a huge task. Does it mean that at the police stage is where most of these particular cases are sort of killed? Is corruption now being driving?
I don't want to accuse the police for corruption,
mm-hmm.
because I can tell you when investigating these murder cases, police work under very difficult circumstances.
Okay.
And as I've told you, that the proper document to prove that death occurred and death was caused by this and this is a postmortem.
Mm-hmm.
You'll find that there are instances or there are places whereby it will take days for the body to be subjected to postmortem because of the lack of facilities or poor road network,
mm-hmm.
or someone was discovered dead after maybe a week or two.
Yeah.
You may be able to conclusively determine what was the cause of death.
Mm-hmm.
And you see, once you don't determine what's the cause of death and link it to the accused person, that becomes a problem. You cannot blame the police for this. You cannot blame the prosecutor for this. You cannot blame the court for this. So there are so many factors that are at play when it comes to investigating and prosecuting cases of murder.
Okay. So what can you cite as the loopholes in terms of prosecuting these cases? You have mentioned, yes, there's lack of finances and the challenges that they face at the police stage. But then sitting on the other side as a criminal lawyer and you're looking at a murder case, what are some of the loopholes that, you know, the lawyer can take advantage of once they realize that indeed their client committed an offense?
You know, there are so many loopholes in criminal cases. Mm-hmm. Yeah, after all, you just need to raise a simple doubt.
Just
a simple doubt. And bring out some inconsistency. What witness A said, what witness B said, so small inconsistencies. And you see, the law says that an inconsistent, however small it is, must be resolved in the favor of the accused person. Why? Because first and foremost, Article 50 of the Constitution says that everybody has a right to a fair hearing.
Yeah.
And our criminal law system is proved beyond reasonable doubt. You are presumed innocent until otherwise proven. So any inconsistency, any loophole must be resolved in favor of the accused person. So you find that, we need to...
But when they say you have to prove it beyond reasonable doubt here in the country, does that threshold, you know, become more retrogressive in terms of delivering justice instead of, you know, working out to make sure that, you know, the criminals are put to book? If you're saying a small doubt can water...
It's because we say that our law provides for presumption of innocence. As you walk out in the streets, you're innocent. Whether you've stolen, whether you've not stolen, whether you've killed, you are innocent until otherwise proven. You know, it will cause a lot of injustice to shift that burden, because they arrest me and take me to court for me to prove my innocence, which is wrong.
Yeah.
They give these stories of an antelope who saw a lion, I don't know, running. You know, I mean, saw an antelope running and they stopped and asked, "Why are you running?" He said, "The lion is eating the antelope." And they told him, well, "This is a hare. This is a rabbit. Why are you running at antelope?" And they said, "In this country, by the time you prove that you are a rabbit, you're going to be in jail."
To prove to
each
and everyone that
So that's why now we have that element of presumption of innocence.
Mm-hmm.
If we were to make it the other way around, a lot of people would be in jail. I just come and report to the police that did this. So they will put me in jail for me to prove that I did not do it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what are the penalty terms in terms of murder and manslaughter?
The punishment for murder is death.
Okay.
But since 1987, there's not been execution. So there was a time we put up a moratorium on executions. So I find that in most cases, these people had life sentences. Some characters went to court and the death penalty, well, it was not removed from statute books, but it was declared unconstitutional, unlawful, and now their sentences were commuted to life in prison.
Okay.
Yes.
But
for manslaughter, it can be 1 minute to life.
1 minute?
Yes, you can be sentenced for 1 hour. Or 1 second.
But what gives the judge the ascertainment of this particular penalty? Is it the issue of degree, or what do they use now to measure the threshold?
Yeah, the degree. Now, what we call now the circumstances. Every case has its own peculiar circumstances. Every case is different from the other. This one may be found guilty or may plead guilty of manslaughter, but you find that the circumstances are different, quite different from this other party B. There's a case. I don't know, it was somewhere, it was reported, it went to court, and the lady acted in self-defense. I think there was a man who wanted to kill her, or maybe some sort of domestic violence issue, and the lady reacted and killed the man. So when this case went to court, and you could see the circumstances here, this lady did not have the intention. She actually, if she had not done it, she would have been killed.
Okay.
So so they did a plea bargain. She pleaded guilty to manslaughter, and she was, the pronouncement of the judge was, your sentence ends the moment I put down my pen. So that means you've been sentenced to 0.11 seconds.
Okay.
And the law allows that.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's quite an interesting, perspective of seeing the law. But when some of these cases come to the court of law, some have said the systemic criminal justice chain that has some sort of a weakness. In terms of the case of the lady who was killed by a British soldier in the UK, and then there was sort of a, in what do they call it, infamous trial. There was a bench that was formed to sort of investigate what were the circumstances of that particular death. But then it took a long time. By the time the family is calling for justice, they cannot even tell where things are going in terms of the justice system. Are those some of the weaknesses that we are seeing in terms of investigating murder cases?
I think that was an isolated case. But generally what I can say is that delay.
Lula ni programu inayokupa fursa ya kutizama video zozote pindi tu unapokuwa na nafasi. Hadithi za kukupa motisha, drama, maisha ya vyuo vikuu, teknolojia, masuala ya jamii, kuzuru maeneo tofauti, spoti, burudani na zaidi. Pata programu ya Lula sasa kwenye rununu yako kwa yote unayohitaji.
And what the law says concerning the incidences that happened, that happens concerning that particular incident, which is a criminal issue in terms of our penal code. Now, Wakili Charles, before we went for a break, we had not touched on the issue, we had touched on the issue of the criminal justice system. I don't know from where you sit, do you think the way the judiciary is handling these cases, given that you have said that the law has no issue, are we doing our very best in terms of tightening the measures in terms of finding the perpetrators culpable?
I think we are doing our very best. The judiciary has been our very best. The prosecution has been our very best. Perhaps you can say the defense lawyers have been better.
Yeah, because now there has been the question on whether the people who have been accused of murder should be granted bail, because some of the times, some of these cases drag, yes, for 2 years, others drag for 3 years, depending on whether an inquiry has been formed. And they've said that murder perpetrators or those accused of murder should not be granted bail. But we see, in some of the cases, we see some lawyers who are very notorious to ensure that, you know.
Do not blame lawyers for that, because murder is a bailable offense.
Okay.
Yes.
But do you think it should be bailable, given that some have said some of the cases drag?
Yeah, it is, because the presumption of innocence. Mm. This person is innocent until proven guilty. If I deny you bond or bail, and the case drags for 10 years, then at the end of the day, you find that I'm guilty. It means I will have served
10 years.
Yeah.
But now, looking at how grave an offense is, murder is quite a grave offense from where I sit, because it denies one right to life, which is a supreme, you know, sort of rights, not only in our country, but also in the universal rights. And therefore, yes, you have said a case may drag for 10 years, but is it upon us as a country to look into the way we can be dealing with these cases, with the agency it requires, to ensure that, you know, we don't get into a scenario whereby those accused of murder are granted bail?
If you look at Article 49 of our Constitution, it provides for the right of arrested persons. So these arrested persons have a right in the Constitution.
Mm-hmm.
Just like this other person has a right to life. And actually, the proponents of the abolishment of the death penalty argue on the pressing of that right to life. The state cannot deprive this person of their life because they committed an offense. So, and as I said, it's about, you know, we live in our legal system is adversarial. All your alleges must prove. So you cannot allege that because you feel like my client committed this offense, we should treat him as a criminal. He's actually not a criminal. He's a suspect until the day a conviction has been pronounced by court. He's treated as that innocent bus walking in the streets. So this argument of bail and no bail, there before actually capital offenses like murder, robbery with violence, and treason, those offenses were not bailable. We also have other jurisdictions where they don't give bail to suspects in capital offenses. But if you look at the evolution of the law over the time, if you look at the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, if you look at the International Convention on People and People Rights, you find that the law has evolved where we are our criminal justice system is actually so much leaning towards the accused person because of this presumption of innocence. Yeah. And the right to a fair hearing, where you are given an opportunity to defend yourself. Sometimes when you're not in prison, you don't have that opportunity to defend yourself. And I can tell you, one thing you should know is that murder suspects who cannot afford lawyers are given advocates by the state at the state's expense. Let me not call it expense, because they pay us 30,000. Per case, and they withhold tax, they pay you 28,500 to conclude the whole case. But a murder trial cannot kick off
without
the state giving you an advocate.
Okay.
The other thing, a murder trial will not kick off until the accused person or the suspect has been subjected to a mental examination. Yeah. So that you see, there are a lot of elements. We have people ailing in this country. And I think I mentioned it before I started the show. It's a topic that we have a topical issue of mental illness. And some of these things that you see happening in this country, there's some funny offenses being committed, like that lady in Kitengela who is accused of stabbing a kid and chopping her into pieces.
Yeah.
We need to, first of all, have a conversation around our criminal justice system, around our psychiatrists and psychological experts on how to deal with this mental aspect, the mental illness, because we find that most of these happenings, you trace them to mental illness. suicides and stuff. Oh, it's all about. Actually, I think it has come to a point where we cannot have a conversation about commission of a crime without having to have a conversation about the mental well-being of the person suspected of having committed that offense. Okay. And there's a case actually pending in court at the Constitutional Commission at the High Court here in Nairobi, where we are asking the court to relook at how we treat survivors of suicide. Because if you look at the penal code, if you attempt suicide and you don't die, you are charged with attempted suicide. Without looking at the reasons that drove you to attempt to take your life. So those are the issues that we need to interrogate. And as I said, before this murdered suspects are tried, they are subjected to a mental assessment so that the court will be able to establish their state of mind at the time they committed the offense. Did they understand? Or do they understand the gravity of the offense that they committed? Because sincerely, someone was telling me, I don't know whether it's true, that even a lion, I'm a physique, I don't know whether that is true or not, because of that sanctity of life.
Yeah. But then, given that you mentioned that in terms of looking into homicide incidents, sometimes our defense lawyers are somewhat smart or a bit witty. Is it an issue of, given that the prosecution is not directly involved in terms of looking for evidence, should we now change the way things are to have the prosecution and the police have some sort of a multi-agency sort of working formula to ensure that they don't come to a court of law with evidence which they cannot really quite, you know, execute in a court of law that now raises chances of loopholes?
Personally, if I was to be asked, or if they were to make me a DPP for a day, okay. It's the high time now we had specific police officers attached to the office of the DPP as investigators, so that they have a central command.
Yeah, that is the DPP.
Yeah, they are directly under the DPP, so that the DPP now will be able to coordinate the investigations. Mm-hmm. Because you see, the DPP is trained. Is a trained lawyer. The prosecutor is a trained lawyer. And they understand the elements of these offenses. So when they're directing these investigations, they'll be able now to do it, filling in the loopholes that may arise during trial. Let lawyers deal with lawyers, because if you let police officers investigate, they always have a loophole. You know, I had a funny witness who was an investigating officer. That guy testified as if he was at the scene. And this man approached this girl, and he spoke to the girl. The girl refused, and the girl ran away. He chased the girl, and he got hold of the girl. He tried to rape her. She screamed, and then he stabbed that girl. A movie. And I asked him a very simple question. Were they at the scene? No. Of all the witnesses that you brought to court, were they at the scene? No. But if this investigator was trained as a lawyer, he would be able now to create a different picture, knowing very well that this is circumstantial evidence. So by the time they're bringing the file to court, their primary piece of evidence will be circumstantial evidence. And you see, when you go to court knowing that this is what I have, you can always defend that. But if you know with this pinky punky that they were saying the other day, you find that you cannot establish the case.
Okay, as we wind up this particular discussion because of time, if the police has looked for the evidence, they've given the evidence to the prosecution, that is the office of the DPP, and the DPP, from where they sit, they find, okay, this case does not hold water, but the family is still aggrieved that the DPP wants to close the file even before the matter is taken to a court of law. What then is the recourse?
The recourse is that if the DPP has recommended that you cannot a case of facts do not establish an offense, and they refuse to charge on actually good grounds, and the family feels that they are aggrieved. There are instances of private prosecutions. Okay. When you apply to court, you conduct the prosecution itself.
Is it successful in terms of these private prosecutions?
Ask the DC to try to privately prosecute material. It wasn't successful. Private investigation prosecutions is an avenue in law, but until it becomes very difficult, because one, you don't have the luxury of police officers, investigators. It is you now to do the police work. Yes.
Does that show that sometimes when some of these families, they're families which are really aggrieved and they feel that the judicial system as well as the prosecution have not granted them the justice, and as you have alluded, that private prosecution sometimes cannot be a recourse. Is that something that, you know, we should go back to the drawing board and find a way of giving these families closure? Because sometimes it can be so bad that they decide to take the matter of their own hands.
Well, as a constitutional law practitioner, I believe that our constitution is very broad. If let me put myself in the shoes of that family, I still go to the High Court to compel the DPP to and argue that the DPP has violated my rights or the rights of the family by not preferring charges. Let them come to court, let us interrogate. And you see, sometimes when cause of death cannot be ascertained, and you cannot establish who killed, and for example, students are shot during riots. And you cannot, the facts cannot point to a particular person who committed the offense. Mm-hmm. Now, the law provides for an inquest.
Yeah.
Where now the magistrate will call the file will be forwarded, and the witness statements will be recorded. And now, an inquest is like a trial before a trial. Now, the magistrate will have an opportunity to interrogate the facts. What the witnesses are saying, what the family is saying, what the victims are saying. And after that interrogation, they can make a recommendation. Yes. The facts established.
But I've said that some of
an offense may have been committed.
They've said some of these inquests have led to some of these cases dying. Some have said that the inquest is just a way of
giving
closure and killing a case before it even gets to the formal.
I don't think that it's killing a case, because actually most of these inquests are very thorough. Mm-hmm. And actually our magistrates are very, very, very keen when it comes to this inquest. Yeah.
All right, so thank you so much for Wakili Chelsea. I'm being told that you're pressed on time. Perhaps what could be your final words in terms of the homicide incidences and the legal perspective concerning that?
My point is short to be that crimes are committed, yes. But what are the circumstances that lead to these things? And an offense may be committed and you may think it's murder, like the Shakaola massacre. What do you guys are calling Shakaola massacre?
Yeah.
But I can tell you, and I'm not representing them, but I can tell you it will become very difficult
to
charge, not even to prove, to prefer charges of murder against that Shakaola mastermind.
Yes. Thank you so much, Wakili Charles Malimo, for your perspective. There you have it. Issues of homicide incidences. If there's anything that you can pick from this particular show, is that when it comes to murder, it's beyond reasonable doubt. There should not be an iota of doubt when it comes to these particular cases to ensure that the perpetrators are found culpable. My name is Irene Mongi. Thanks so much for watching. Have a splendid night.